is called Wrestling for Saddam, held hostage by a monster. I was brought over to wrestle Adnan Kaissey and beat him. I had beat him, and that's the critical phrase, beat him. He had worked against a guy named George Gordienko, who was one of the best top wrestlers in the world. He couldn't wrestle in the United States because he'd been framed for being a member or dating a woman who had been in the Communist Party. So he was banned from working in the United States. He was one of the top wrestlers. He was in several Hall of Fames. He was wrestled heavyweight of the year in England, Commonwealth, British heavyweight champion. He was one of the top guys in the world. Well, he was the first guy. He was in the Hall of Fame when he wrestled. He was the first guy to wrestle Kaissey. The match drew 200,000 people and all Mid-East TV. The second guy was a year and a half later. They didn't have these matches like every week. But a year and a half later, they had the second match. It was on the anniversary of the 50th anniversary of the Iraqi army being formed. And the opponent for the second match was Andre the Giant. He wasn't Andre yet. He was still, that was about a year later when he went to, McMahon Sr. got a hold of him and changed his name and his style of work. At the time, he was called Monster Rusamov, but he was still 7 feet, what I heard. He wasn't as heavy as he was later, but he's probably 450, 500 pounds. And the way he and Kaissey promoted their match, they walked the streets of Baghdad and all over the country for a week. They'd go out one day in one city and walk the streets to the bazaars together. And, you know, here's a 7'4", you know, 500-pound guy. Kaissey probably looked like a midget next to him. And that's the way they promoted the match. Well, they had 200,000 people, and another 100,000 people couldn't get in the stadium. Were milling around outside, and he beat both these guys two straight falls, because Gordienko was supposed to take a fall, but he did. Kaissey won the first fall by pinning Gordienko, but you had to win two out of three falls. It was a Commonwealth rules. 3 20-minute periods in a 60-minute. Total time limit, 3 20-minute periods. You had to win two periods. You could win by disqualification, but you had to win two of the three in order to win the match. Kaissey beat Gordienko, I believe, by pinning in the first fall. Gordienko was supposed to take the second fall. But the Iraqi wrestling fans had no idea. They had no clue what was going on. There were no ways, nobody explained any of the rules to them, and there was no way to get the rules to them. When they raised Kaissey's hand after he won the first fall, everybody in the audience thought he'd won the match, and he was the new European heavyweight champion. They went crazy. It was a joy. It was exuberation. It wasn't anger, but they went crazy. And they tried to rush the ring, and they wanted to embrace Kaissey. I don't know. They might have ripped him apart. Like, remember how the Beatles used to run whenever they saw a crowd coming near them?
Yes.
They'd run for their life in that movie. Well, that's what Kaissey and Gordienko felt like. But, you know, the Beatles were worried about being torn apart, and people would say, oh, I just want to get a lock of Ringo's hair or whatever. There was such a furious riot that when they discovered the governor of Baghdad, that all the politicos were sitting ringside, and when he discovered that the match had to be restarted, it wasn't over yet, he directed his goons, the heads of his goons, the generals. They had about 1,000 commandos with AK-47s and bayonets around the ring. He ordered them to restore order so the match could restart. Well, they started rifle butts and they punching, kicking, whatever. And I'm talking about women, and I don't think there were many children there, but there might have been young people, preteens, but old men, women, whoever was trying to get into the ring or trying to get in the ring to touch Kaissey. I call it Kaissey craziness because they just were nuts. That they were trying to, then they, people that would, they couldn't rifle butt, they were trying to pull them away. People would hang on to the ring rope,
Yeah, right. He already did one. Oh my God.
No, it was against Andre. He was going to have Andre take a fall because what he wanted, what Casey wanted, he wanted to do have Andre take a fall, then he could make the glorious comeback like American wrestling or Western style wrestling. Then he could make a big glorious comeback in the third fall, and it was a big triumphal thing. You know, you just beat a guy too straight. I mean, that's there's not really that drama, is there? When it's why your opponents want to fall, you want to fall, now it's a third fall, boy, now it's all for all the marbles. That's a lot more dramatic than two just squash that guy two straight falls, right? So, Casey writes his book. I mean, I've got his book sitting right here. I'm not reading it, I read it twice. But he said that Saddam came up to him before the match with Andre. He called him on his way out of the tunnel to enter the stadium. And he said, we're all counting on you. The whole country's counting on you. This guy is big, but he's a wimp. If he hurts you even a little in any way, he's going to get this. And he showed Casey his pistol, his holstered 45 revolver. He said, I'll empty this into his fat head and send it back to France in a box. That's what Casey says. That's what he said. He said it on an interview with Mike Mooneyham. I heard that interview on TV, and I went, what? I didn't know Saddam Hussein was involved in this crap. And so I got the book, and I read it. And so Andre was supposed to take a fall also, but Casey was afraid. Casey, actually... And again, I sound like I'm knocking him, but he's still alive. He can defend himself. He said he was more worried about being shot by having Andre cover him, like for a fall, and then Saddam shooting Andre right there. He was worried about getting shot himself in the process. So they changed it that he beat Andre too straight. He became so popular by doing it that Saddam started looking at him like, hey, you know, I hear more people saying Adnan Casey than I hear saying Saddam Hussein. Are you a threat to me? And he started looking at him with that kind of a, you know, anytime Saddam looked at you anyway, he bought people who thought they were going to get a raise and a promotion, and he'd kill you, shot him on the spot. Anybody he perceived as a rival